volunteers who would help us in that respect. We don't anticipate there'll be any additional cost with this, because we've got people who probably do that now. So not really anticipating any additional cost in respect of assisting those people who want to use our services that aren't using it at the moment. Mm-hmm. In the future, so there won't be any additional cost.
No, just that's my good question then. But it will be an improved service for those who live.
Yes, indeed, yeah. We're trying to specifically target people with a disability to come forward and use the services in the future. Yes, it will be an advanced program, 6-week program, which could offer them some advice about how to use the equipment and a program exercise thereafter.
It does say that those who no longer meet the criteria after this date will convert to corporate invigorated membership. So my understanding, please correct me if I'm wrong, my understanding is that unless you're in receipt of disability evidence benefits, you'll still be eligible for all the benefits of the corporate invigorated. Is that right? So in other words, all serving armed forces personnel who come home for recuperation and rest will still have all the benefits of that, and those who are not eligible, regardless of personnel or veterans will all still receive free use of leisure facilities under the corporate package. So the two servicemen we heard from before will still be able to use the swimming baths and many of the facilities already on offer.
In terms of the covenant, it's an interesting one, because I want members of this committee to know that in terms of the deliberations of the office, I sat here dealing with a job as part of it, it's about representing the armed forces community. It's something that I've sat and thought long and hard about myself, and it's a difficult situation to be in. However, having said that, the armed forces community covenant, proud people that ex-forces people are, the covenant clearly lays out that it's about equity. It's about not the armed forces being treated differently, it's about them being treated fairly with equal status. And in some areas, that's being taken to mean that we don't want to stand out and we don't want to be people who want to go about our lives as normal. And in others, it means that we want to be seen as individuals and those groups. So in terms of the covenant, the spirit of the covenant, we as a local authority, and we should all be there, we do a fantastic amount for our armed forces, from the war graves and commissions and the cenotaphs and all the work that Peter Lee does around that, to the armed forces forum that I chair with a lot of other public sector bodies, all coming together to try and make sure that the services that we offer do respect people's time in the forces. But it also needs to reflect, I would suggest, again as an armed forces, an ex-armed or a veteran, that it cannot, and it didn't sit comfortably to me, that somebody who is in the seat of a living wage or a wage to undertake a choice, a lifestyle choice, which is their choice to make at that time, I believe the board says, then what makes them any different? And maybe it's a bit emotional as an officer, but what makes them any different than a serving policeman, than a serving firefighter, than a serving, etc. So in some of this, the deliberation that I had was about equity in those circumstances as well. And that was my view on it really. So I hope that helps it to answer the question.
Thank you, Chair. These facilities are provided for by the council taxpayers, and all well and good, and that's how it should be. But we heard from the cabinet member about abuse of the scheme. Can you just outline what the evidence of the abuse of the scheme and whether the new policies will eliminate that? Hopefully eliminate that abuse.
Yeah, through you, Chair. A little bit is anecdotal because some of these stories over time get exaggerated slightly, but you can understand sometimes how they've developed. Because we had an honest conversation with the TA facility in Chequick about a booking that took place at the TA centre, which was a biocide booking, and it was 10 TA members. And I think because it became a regular booking, the same time each week, it became a regular booking with us as well, it became a regular booking with them. But there are times where they couldn't get 10 people to play five sides, and they might get six. So four of their friends turn up, and then it becomes six of their friends, and then it's eight of their friends. And over time, the essence of what we were trying to do was dwindled out. It turns around that the whole tent layers are non-serving members of the armed forces. And we have instances where we have people booking two squash books. One member booking two squash books and he brings three mates. Things like that are highlighted and have been highlighted to us by the staff groups that we talked to. And we did talk to about going forward with this pricing policy. So some of this has developed a return steam in terms of anecdotal information that we've received back, and I can understand how, but some of this is still prevalent today. Going forward, we hope that we accept single bookings, and we do the bookings through administration through our colleagues in AMO, and that will help alleviate.
I did say we'll give the policy. What I meant was if the new policy was to be put in force, that's what I meant.
That's a fair thing, Councillor Williams. Is there anybody else after that who wants to make a comment? Councillor Williams, Councillor Lakey, last. Councillor Burns. Thank you very much. Just indulge me for a moment. Thank you. is, I'm sure, absolutely equitable that the armed forces personnel that we give discounts to should be people who live in rural. Isn't that enough? Does that not, together with a robust system which makes sure that the people who are given a pass are entitled to it, isn't that good enough? Could there not just be a system that said, if somebody's only been in the TA 5 days and they've not done anything? That seems to be like a spurious example. You could be in the armed services, as was mentioned before, for 5 days and go overseas and be blown up.
I think what the emphasis is sort of been there is I was given an opinion on what you just said.
Moving forward, I'm going to take this. question to Ms. Fisher. If all 2,835, which is what I'm going to do, took, who had the £22.50 per month pass, what was the cost of the council? I mean, well, I can tell you it's 765,450 pounds. I would have thought you'd have known that. You are trying to bring income and make savings. All the other things to have. So if you're going to take, if those 1,519 people who don't maybe not have any discretion, and then all decide you're going to pay 250 per month, what income will that bring to the council? Because it's not making any savings, you said before. Even though the cabinet report says savings, you're denying that the removal of this pass is making any savings.
Sorry, Jeff, if you bring the income in, but I this time of the evening, I've done come down, you calculate just to make those calculations. Apologies.
One more final question, and it is a final question. What savings do you envisage this council making by removing this pass from 1519?
I think that that's enough already, but do you want to read the answer from the agent?
This is not predicated, this proposal is not predicated on savings, Chair. This proposal is about making sure that those people who can't pay do pay. And it is not about making savings, but if there is income that people, that result from people paying for their pass because they are able to pay, then that is a benefit to the council.
Thank you, and as you said, it's your final question. Can I say thank you very much? And one more voice.
Chair, it's okay. I'm going to sit up here with Tina. That's okay.
I'm going to go back into the corner now.
No, you're not.
Not the hot seat.
Cheers.
Somebody say chair to me. I hear a voice saying chair. That's the worst I've been on. No. Tina, first of all, apologies for giving you away to sit on. I'm sorry, I don't know anything about you. Would you like to tell us a little bit about yourself and the organisation you're representing?
About a year and a half ago, we set up another organisation as a one-stop shop for veterans on the Wirral because we felt it was much needed, called AMO, the All Military Members Organisation. It's for families as well. Before that, it was Wirral Veterans, as you know, and I used to attend there as well. But obviously, for reasons, that didn't work out. But we took over with AMO, and it's really progressing really well. We have 72 people who've got PTSD at the moment, PTSD sufferers, mental health, and they have their gym passes and it helps with their well-being. I've got about 31 physically injured, kneecaps, replacement, no legs. They actually use the gym. We all go as a group together if we can because some people don't like to go out on their own. So we have an outreach service as well where we take the veterans out or help them with the garden or the housing. So there you go. Having these like little chats and that with Mark Hamborn and things, and obviously the veterans that come through the door, we were talking about the gym passes, and it seemed like, I don't know, maybe the first time you wanted it was for serving veterans, was it? Personnel and veterans, to reward them, to say thanks, well done. But it seems like there's been crosswires where people are just going for these gym passes and maybe not using the proper paperwork for it or discharge papers. So speaking with Mark Camborne and Dean, we came up with a different kind of criteria just to help along the way about getting them their gym passes, because we don't want to scrap it because it helps a lot and it helps with AMO and the members that come. But people like I've also asked serving personnel who are still serving, they have their gym passes, but they said they'd happily pay half of that price to put back in to the leisure services so we don't lose the gym pass. Does that make sense?
Anybody else want to ask any questions? Thanks, Peter. Are you a local organisation or are you affiliated to a national organisation?
No, we're a local organisation from Merrill.
Okay. You just said there that it's some saving personnel said they would pay a sum towards a passage or to save the passage.
Yeah.
Does that mean you're opposed to removing passes?
No, we're removing any of them. I don't think it's about removing the passes, I think it's just getting the criteria a bit more tightened up and to help to put more back into the legislature so they don't lose the pass. I don't feel to take the passes off them. I think maybe the new ones that are coming in to get the passes through AMO, we can help.
So you would like to maintain the status quo but move it forward?
Yeah,
I think move it forward to a more stringent. So you wouldn't want to see any veterans remove their passes?
Not at this moment in time.
Anybody that currently has a pass, you wouldn't want to see anyone then lose it?
No, because at the end of the day, you wouldn't want to call the pass off them, would you really? And do you know what their updated statuses is? Like new addresses?
And you're representing the armed forces.
Sorry, just a bit of clarity for myself. All serving armed forces personnel, all veterans, will still have a pass, but they will also have the opportunity to upgrade to a higher level of pass should they wish to. So we're not talking about, we keep using this language of taking passes off people. We're not taking passes off anybody. Every, unless I'm completely wrong here, every member of the armed forces, every veteran, every TA member will still have corporate invigorator pass, so they'll still be able to go to the swimming baths free, they'll still have all the discounts free, they'll still have unlimited access to gymnasiums, but they'll also have the opportunity to upgrade the pass should they wish to.
That's it, and that was the
Sorry.
Is anybody else want to ask Tina a question? Yes,
ma'am. Sorry, Tina, I didn't hear whether you are you ex service or?
I am, and I've got family still serving and ex personnel.
Chair, I'm grateful for the opportunity to respond. I think it's been a very productive session and an example of what scrutiny should be. However, I am none the wiser in terms of the detail of this particular scheme, unfortunately, and I doubt very much that anyone behind me is, judging by the conversation that was happening between the Cabinet Member and one of our witnesses, Ken Hannigan. Clearly, the Cabinet Member feels as though he will be eligible, but there is the doubt.
This is
something that will elucidate the case. The fact is, this policy is creating confusion, Chairman. Yeah, I've just witnessed it here this evening. Why are we injecting this confusion into an already existing scheme which does well for the veterans and serving members of our armed forces? Why are we doing it? We are told it's not because of money, it's not because of any financial reason, although I have an email here from the strategic director saying the council will save, or in terms of generating income, £50,000 per annum. It seems as though, no, that's not the case. We're not having more money as a result of this policy. So then why are we? We are told it's because we want to make the system more equitable. Those who are able to pay should pay. Well, let me remind the committee that this isn't a type of means testing. You aren't asking veterans to come up with their bank statements or their employment status. That's not the case at all. What you are saying is, unless you have a disabling injury, you will not be entitled to the pass. The pass will be taken away. So just like the lady from AMO, just like the lady from AMO didn't want any passes taken away, I'm afraid this new power